turn it in for you.
We'll get back to the agenda, the public speakers. The only name we have is Mr. Tony Cox. Mr. Cox?
Is he here?
I think he's done.
He ain't in here.
Can they hear in there? Okay, we'll move on, and the next item is the watershed ordinance. Jason?
Yeah, if they did.
This is for a public hearing also.
Chairman Smith, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packet a action item request for a proposed amendment to Section 102 of the watershed ordinance. This came about, planning staff discovered a discrepancy between the watershed ordinance and the subdivision ordinance. Under the subdivision ordinance, exempt plats or exemptions to that ordinance, settling a family estate is an exemption under the subdivision ordinance. Under the watershed ordinance, there are minimum lot size requirements of 1 acre or 2 acres. This could create an issue where something could be approved or recorded by deed that creates new lots that are perfectly legal under the subdivision ordinance but would create a violation under the watershed ordinance. So as a response to that, staff has recommended a new exemption under Section 102 of the ordinance. Within the packet, you should have a copy of that language. It would be under Section 102, subsection E. The division of property among heirs for the sole purpose of settling an active estate shall be exempt from the minimum lot size requirements of this ordinance. The Alamance County Planning Board did vote unanimously on March 13th to recommend approval to you all of that amendment. And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions from the board at this time.
Can I have a motion to go into public hearing?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. Ladies,
I vote. Anybody in the room, as it is now made up, have anything to say concerning this amendment to our watershed ordinance?
Appears we've done a lot of changes to this watershed stuff, and we've done some ordinances involving this watershed stuff. And what we just seen, Ms. Sutton, I applaud you for standing up for the rule of law. Bending the rules and bending the laws for some and not for all. Special people, special circumstances. I hear about this sovereign citizen movement out here, and it appears that's what we're doing. We're going away from the Constitution. I heard several people in here say that they were happy, and I would be happy too if it went my way. But Mr. Sutton, he talked about the history of these lines and so forth. And I believe most of them, if not all of them, talked about these lines that they knew were there. And in this watershed stuff here, I don't know. Whole lot of confusion going on. But, hey,
anybody else want to be heard on the watershed amendment? Nobody else wants to be heard. Is there a motion to come out of public hearing?
So moved.
There's a second.
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any comments from the board?
I thought that selling an estate was already exempt.
It is under the subdivision ordinance for the county, but under the watershed ordinance it is not.
Okay, thank you.
Is there a motion to approve this amendment?
So moved.
Just a second?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Motion carries. Thank you, Jason. Fire district rate increases, their presentation, Mr. Finance Officer?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Commissioners, we in the finance area have received the budget requests for the various volunteer fire departments in the county. You have before you a single sheet, it's a horizontal sheet with the summary fire department information and the current tax rates offered. The information agenda item states that any fire department that's requesting an increase must make a presentation. That's not exactly right. We invite them to make a presentation at the request of the board. We have two fire departments this year that are requesting a tax increase. The chiefs of each of those are with us tonight to state their case. This is not an action item. This is simply a presentation each of them will offer as to their justification for the increases. We will act on all of the budget requests, including the fire department requests, at a later date. So at this time, I'd like to invite from Altamont Ossipee Fire Department Chief Michael Burnett, who would like to talk a little bit about what's going on there. You also have in front of you an additional supplement that I handed out with fire department name on top of it being Altamont Ossipee. Chief, welcome.
Hey.
Hey, Michael.
I'm going to give you another handout. I know some of it is
okay.
included
okay.
with your budget.
Thank you, Mike.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's all.
Okay. Thank you. Make sure one.
I appreciate the opportunity to be able to stand here and explain as to why we need a 1 cent increase. In presenting our budget, we usually sit down and make up a budget that's went over by our officers of the fire department and approved. Then it's presented to our fire department personnel for a vote. And at that time, it goes to our board of directors, which is a elected committee from the perimeters of our district. Our board met on March 31st, and we went over the budget line item. I had discussions. They approved me to present to y'all a 1 cent increase. What this 1 cent increase will do, we'll be able to keep one full-time man and one part-time position on our payroll. Without this 1 cent increase, we will have to lay off. In June 2012, we was inspected by the Department of Insurance for our ISO rating. When he finished his evaluation and we got the grades back, we were currently a class 6 and we had went up to a class 7, which, you know, the lower the number, the better. When he done our review on it, he explained that we needed two more engine companies or pumper trucks and two substations to cover our district. In working with it, we found out we could go with one more engine or pumper and one substation, and we asked for a grace period. They gave us a year. He came back in August of 2013, and after reviewing where we had purchased a new truck and built the substation, we were granted our class 6 rating, 4 points from getting a class 5. So, you know, that's where the money shifted. When we had to buy a new truck and build a substation, that took the money that we had in the budget for the paid personnel. One of these positions that will be eliminated if we don't have the increase is at that substation, 8 to 5. When we started talking about the increase at the station, I told them I would rather come stand before y'all for a 1 cent increase than stand before the people of that community up there when I tell them they don't have their paid man anymore. It'll be an unmanned station during the daytime. Our personnel, we have 4 on duty during the day, and that, for 99% of the time, is all we have during the daytime, 8 to 5, 7 to 6. We rely on mutual aid. We rely on the fire marshal's office staff to bring us, you know, the additional help that we need. As I said, we had to buy the new truck and build the substation. The packet I gave you is most of that you have received already, but let's see which page. The next to the last page explains the evaluation of our district, the estimated income, and what each penny equals. The one penny increase will bring us $39,000 roughly. That will pay the salary of that full-time position and the part-time. We're asking for that in order to be able to keep our staffing as it is at this time while we were inspected for by the Department of Insurance. On the last page of that handout I gave you gives our banking information. One thing that most of us have asked or inquired about, when we get our budget packet from the county, they want to know what our banking account is December 31st. And that's not a good number to look at because we get our money mostly September, October, have a big bank account. But then come March on around back to September again, it dwindles. So as you see in front of you, that's our true account as of today. The checking account, $73,000. That's money to be used from now until roughly September when we get another check from the county. The $50,000 in cash reserve, that's used for emergencies such as a blown engine, I have to get some tires or something along that line, add backup to the checking account. If come around August, September, we're running low with the checking account, we can move that money over. In that savings account with the $40,000, when we bought the new truck last year, we acquired a loan through the USDA. Part of their requirement is that we keep 1 year truck payment in the bank for the duration of the loan. That loan was $30,222 a year. And then the relief fund is a fund that is set up by the state off of insurance collections as a percentage that's sent back to each county. That money can only be used in the dire needs of a firefighter, been injured, is losing his job, you know, he's losing his income, his house. We can petition for them to let us use some of that money. So that's not a, the relief fund is not a true account that we can spend. But that, you know, is where we stand at this point. And as I said, I, you know, would ask that y'all would consider granting the 1 cent increase so we can maintain where we're at this point. Our budget sheet shows you, you know, the one we submit to the county also shows line item, what we spend. It's a true budget. When we sit down and make out the deep power account, we look at what we spent the last year and kind of adjust it to what it needs to be. So, you know, there's no padding in there, so to say. It's a true account budget.
Any questions for the chief?
Would you go over the rating scenario one more time for me?
Okay, on the ISO, Department of Insurance, on the rating scenario, it's a 10 positions, 10 being the worst, 1 being the best. We had, I'm glad you brought this up, we had area in our district that was a 10. Their insurance companies, if they could find insurance, had high rates. When we built the substation and had it inspected and approved by the state, several of the people in that area came by and told us that they saved $700 to $800 on their fire insurance. Because at first they was 10 miles, or I'm sorry, they was in a class 10, which was 5 miles or better. So, you know, they've really reaped the benefits here that the substation's provided for them. It's brought them all into a class 6 rated district. And as far as on the insurance part, the state comes in, they do an inspection of your equipment, they go through your records, they go through the county, some of the county stuff like central communications, and they have a set grid of what we need to provide. They have a sheet that they pull out, go to each truck in your station, and they want to see this piece of equipment. And some of it is foolish to have, but the state says you have it. And we did meet all the requirements once we bought that new engine and equipment for it.
How long have you been a 6?
We've been a six since 1989, I think it was.
How close are you to a five?
4 points.
4 points. Out of?
If I had the scale, the way they do it, I think a class six is like a 30 to 39, and then, you know, the 40 up would be a class
so you're
five.
On, okay. How many fives do we have versus sixes, and do we have any fours?
We've got a couple threes, sir.
Okay.
There's no fours. Westville's a five in their town. The rest are six and sevens.
Who's a seven?
Fawcett.
North Central.
Yes, sir.
Your rural departments such as AO, North Central, Fawcett, the six is probably the best that they can obtain. When you get the five and below, that's municipalities with water systems. That's what makes the big difference, the water system. Or we rely on trucks to haul water.
But, how many pumpers you got? You got two.
We got two now.
Two pumpers.
We got two now. We have two pumpers, two tankers, a rescue truck, and then our EMT brush truck.
Any further questions for the chief? Thank you very much, chief.
Thank you.
Mebbin? Mebbin?
Yes, sir. Tonight we have with us Chief Bob Lewis, who is chief of the Mebbin Fire Department. That is a municipal fire department. However, they also serve the East Alamance Fire District, which was formed back in 2001. I believe this is the first tax increase requested since inception. Welcome, sir.
That's correct. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I appreciate your time tonight. You should have gotten a detailed letter that lists the contributing factors for the tax increase of 2 cents. I'm just going to briefly hit the high spots, but what we're currently trying to do, we're in the process of building a third station and getting it operational. We want to man that station with an engine company with 12 total personnel. And we just recently purchased replaced two pumpers. So our debt service is going to be about $1.1 million this coming budget year for 2014-2015. The 2 cent tax increase will generate approximately $79,000. That cost will go to partial the staffing, some of the staffing, and then operational cost.
What is your rating now, Chief?
Our rating, we actually have a split rating. We have a 3 inside the city and a 5 outside of the city. The city's based on the municipal water supply. The rural district's based on the water hauling.
Any further questions for the chief? Thank you, Chief. Appreciate
it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Finance officer, you got anything else?
No, sir.
County manager?
No, sir. Nothing at this time.
Any commissioners' comments? Do I hear a motion to adjourn? All in favor?
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners' Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners' Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.